So after this bit of housekeeping, it's time to start the online lab with Linda and Bridget. Welcome, ladies.
Welcome, everyone. Today is the first day of starting to plot a better journalistic future. So welcome to our session. I'm Linda Shaw with the Solutions Journalism Network. And I'm here with Bridget Thornson. And we're here today to discuss 16 steps that will help you on this journey in a workshop way. So we want you to start thinking about a story idea that you can apply these 16 steps to that we'll give you time to do after we discuss them. So just take 1 second to think about that as we get going. Or Bridget, do you want to introduce yourself as well?
Absolutely. Thank you, Linda. My name is Bridget Thorson. I'm an engagement manager at Harkin, and we'll get to the next slide in a moment where we get to say hello. You can follow me if you're interested in engagement journalism, and we'll be talking about that today, the process of listening to your audience and prospective audiences to inform your reporting. You can follow me at the Twitter handle there. You can also find Harkin online at weareharkin.com. We are an engagement consultancy that also offers technology to facilitate your listening. Our U.S. headquarters is in Chicago. I'm joining you today from Wisconsin. And our European headquarters is in Denmark. And Linda, I'll hand it over to you.
Yeah, and again, I'm Linda Shaw from the Solutions Journalism Network, a nonprofit that's about 7 years old, with a mission to spread the practice of solutions journalism, which we define as rigorous reporting into responses to social problems. In other words, to really apply the tools of investigative reporting to what's going right as well as what's going wrong. We're headquartered in New York, although I'm based in Seattle and have colleagues all over the United States and in Europe. We put this presentation together in part because we realize that engagement and solutions journalism really go so well together. We say it's sort of like peanut butter and jelly, better together, and will really help increase the quality and the impact of your journalism. So what we're going to do today is go through the 16 steps that will help you plot your course. Discuss an example of how some news organization has already done that. And then we're going to workshop your plans. Think about that story idea and have that ready, because we'll be going through the steps that you can apply to that idea.
So as everyone is thinking about that idea for what you want to workshop, we're going to start by talking through this case study. And before I move to the next slide, I want to let you know that we'll have time for questions on engagement reporting specifically after this part of the presentation. So please, please do think of those questions, ask those questions. We want to be here to support you. So we're going to start today by looking at KPCC, which is a public radio station in Los Angeles. And if you're interested in the field of engagement journalism, I would really recommend checking out their work. They're very generous about sharing their insights from engagement. And it's helpful to start with a definition of what we mean when we talk about engagement journalism, because this is a term that is bandied about a lot in the industry. At Harkin, we pursue engagement journalism that is really based on listening to surface and respond to critical information needs from those you're trying to serve. So this goes beyond, for example, getting likes on a social media post, right? This is really deep listening that informs your journalism so you can fulfill your pledge to your audiences and serve that mission. And that's why I love KPCC as an example, because this particular project was, they wanted to hold an event on the infant mortality crisis among the Black community. And they were looking specifically to attract African-American women of childbearing age, but African-Americans made up only about 8% of their listeners. So with a grant, they sent out nearly 6,000 postcards to specific, mostly African-American neighborhoods with high rates of infant mortality. They also used flyers. They also had an outreach database. And I want to pause here for a moment and think about the many things KPCC did right and the considerations you can make for your own idea for your project, because they knew right off the bat what their goal was, right? We want to hold an event on this. And they also knew who they were trying to reach. With any engagement project, that's where you want to start. And I want to make a really important point here, and that is when we talk about engagement, it is a process and not a product. It is a process and not a product. You are never going to be able to check off a box that says, engagement has been achieved for our newsroom. What is next, right? And I think as journalists, we are so used to having to complete 100% perfect, polished, amazing stories or series or packages that we don't give enough room to experimentation and the idea that you can learn from what you're doing. So this is just one component of an ongoing process at KPCC. And I would encourage you, as you pursue your own ideas with this checklist, not to be held back by the feeling that if it doesn't go perfectly, it's a failure. If it doesn't go perfectly, it's a learning opportunity. I also like this example because they didn't turn only to digital for their outreach. That's another thing we hear a lot, that engagement means digital outreach. It certainly can, but I would like you to think expansively about every possible platform you could use to reach people, every possible partnership you could use to reach people. And that, again, is going to be informed by understanding what the goal is for your project and who you're trying to hear from. In this case, they sent out flyers. They've also done that this year with their coronavirus coverage. They produced mailers in both English and Spanish pointing to resources that they sent out to certain neighborhoods and used that to facilitate meeting their community's information needs. So they sent out this outreach effort and then they held the event. And you can see here, they made twice their original goal. So that's another key component. You need to understand what metrics you're going to use to evaluate your success. And again, we're having a learning mindset here. The metrics should allow you to understand how well you're doing toward meeting your goal, so you can change course if needed. This isn't a zero-sum game. You haven't failed if you haven't met your goal. If you haven't met your goal, that's simply an opportunity for future growth. But you'll never know if you're being successful or if you need to change course if you don't understand what your goal is at the outset. You can also see that they did very well in reaching their target audience. More than 90% of the audience presented as Black women. And here's the part that I think really brings this together. Over half of the people who RSVP'd said they had heard about the event in a way other than our traditional outreach model. Over half of the people heard about it in a way that was new to the station. And here is where you can really see the possibility of engagement come to life, because they are trying new ways to reach people with crucial information, absolutely crucial information about how they can understand what's happening in their community better, and it's working. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Linda to talk about the solutions component of this project.
Yeah, so KPCC didn't incorporate solutions journalism into this project as well as that very strong engagement that Bridget just discussed. I just wanted to take one moment to say, if we keep referencing this checklist, some of you may have seen it, some of you may have not. We'll be giving you a list, a link at the end in our PowerPoint that you'll be able to find that full checklist for yourself. But we'll be going over the steps throughout this presentation. So here's what KPCC did really well in terms of its solutions journalism for this project. They started out obviously with a problem, a big problem. In the United States as a whole, and I think the infant mortality rate among Black infants is twice the rate of white infants. And in LA County, I think it was three times the rate. And they did a lot of reporting to illuminate and help people understand the breadth and depth of that problem. But they didn't stop there. As you could see in their engagement, they were most interested in making sure they reached their full audience, but also particularly the people most affected by that problem, which were Black women and Black families. So they didn't stop at just reporting the problem. Those folks really want to understand how to solve the problem as well, right? They're most, everybody's interested in solving the problem, but particularly Black families are interested in how to solve that problem. So they started to ask the key question, solutions journalism question, who's doing it better? And started to look for areas where Black infant mortality was going down. And they came across somewhere not too far away from Los Angeles, where they're based. Sacramento had actually been, the city of Sacramento had been tackling this problem for about 2 or 3 years ahead of LA County had started to address it, but Sacramento had started earlier. So they went to Sacramento to write about what they'd done and how. And we can go to the next slide. And then the first question they asked, and this is one of those 16 steps, is to identify who's doing it better and asking, how do we know? One key to solutions journalism and doing solutions journalism as well is looking for that evidence. This solutions journalism is not just about good ideas. It's about good ideas that have evidence that they're making a difference. And the reporter here found strong evidence that the effort in Sacramento was making a difference. As you can see on this chart, the death rate in certain areas was going down even faster than they'd hoped, including sleep-related deaths, in child abuse, and third-party homicide. I can't stress how much how key evidence is to the strength of these stories. That's really sort of the first question you ask. What evidence is there? If you're going to look at something that appears to be making a difference and write about it as solutions journalism, you need that evidence about how it's making a difference. It can be qualitative evidence as well as quantitative evidence, but you have to have some kind of evidence. You can go to the next one. Yeah. The third step is asking how they pulled it off. These stories often work very well as we call them howdunits, where the narrative is really driven by, the journey that the effort took, what they tried, what challenges they faced, how they overcame them. It can be a very nice narrative arc. And step four, step four is what are the limitations? So you can also see here in this chart that she didn't just talk about what was going well. She also identified what wasn't going quite so well yet. And that was perinatal conditions, right? That was one area that still wasn't going down. For the strength of these stories, they're not advocacy. You really look at the limitations as well as the strengths of the effort. And she didn't just stop at Sacramento. She kept asking that question, who's doing it better? And looked at various places that have different models that she thought were worth her community considering. This is one out of Ohio that got dads involved in fighting Black infant mortality.
So we're going to pause here for a moment, and I would like to invite you all to ask your questions about this overall approach. You can ask why engagement or why solutions or how do I make the case to do this to my boss? And also consider what topic, what idea you want to workshop in the remainder of our time today. If you are willing to share and put it in the comments so other people can see what ideas you're considering, that would be wonderful. So please take a moment. We'll pause and give you time, space to think. And feel free to ask us your questions about the overall approach to engagement in solutions journalism before we get our hands into the work with your own ideas, which you can share in the chat.
Hey, so yes, looking at the chat, we didn't receive any questions yet. So I would like to encourage everyone to put your questions in the live chat and to please proceed with all of the work that we are going to dive into.
All right, let's dive into the work. From X to Y, we're not doing an alphabet game. We're going to think about where your idea, where your story, where your project is currently, or perhaps what your relationship looks like with your audience or with your prospective audiences currently, and where you would like it to go. If you have anything handy to jot down some notes on, that would be great. If you want to just type an email to yourself, this is designed to get you thinking about where you'd like to go, because again, it's essential to have that goal in mind to understand and inform the strategy you're going to put into place. All right, so everyone's got their idea in their mind. We're ready. I'm just visualizing a room of people poised over notebooks. All right, three questions for you. What's your overall goal for covering this topic? And this should be a North Star vision. This should be something that will guide your strategy throughout your project. It can be something that you share out with your audience. It can be something that you share internally. There can be both versions, right? But it should be inspirational. This should be the thing that you are passionate about, the reason you're putting your effort into this project. It can be as long or as short as you want it to be. We've been working a lot lately with US newsrooms on election coverage, right? One of our newsrooms said they wanted their voter guide to be easier than building IKEA furniture for voting, okay? Something that describes the service you're going to provide. Again, it's a process, not a product. So just draft your ideas. I'll give you a moment to think and write that down. What's your overall goal? Another way to ask this, what problem are you trying to solve? If you're willing to share in the chat to give other people a look at what you're thinking about, please do so. Okay, with that initial goal in mind, who do you need to reach to inform your reporting? This is not about who you're sharing the reporting out with after it's produced. This is about finding people that you can bring together to find out what they need to know. And then finally, like Linda said, where can you look to find who's doing it better? Where can you look to find who's doing it better? In my mind, I hear the scratching of pens on paper, Linda. I hope you hear it too. All right. So again, this is just an initial draft. This is a really great exercise that you can bring back to your newsrooms. These three questions, easily an hour-long discussion and mapping on the walls, right? So we're going to get more into mapping your plan. If you haven't had the opportunity to really think through your responses to these three questions, that's okay. As Linda mentioned, we have a checklist that will allow us to allow you to map this out as we go. Okay, so let's map out your plan. Look at this weird, like kind of lava lamp looking thing. I promise there's a reason for this. This is how you can think about who you want to reach, right? This is that component of the engagement outreach. So in the center bubble, you're going to put your topic or story idea. And again, if you can, just start drafting this out. What are you looking to cover? What topic do you care about? And then you can map out groups of people who care about, have opinions about, or maybe impacted by that topic or idea. How do I group people? You say, however you want. It's just a mental mapping exercise. You can also use the space of this network mapping activity to show groups that are perhaps more closely related to the topic you're talking about. Maybe they're bigger in size. Maybe they've got a deeper relationship with your organization. Maybe there are groups you're not currently reaching that you want to list on the side, right? KPCC, for example, knew that only, I think, 8% of their listeners were from the community they were trying to reach. Opportunity for new outreach approaches. As you sketch this out, I encourage you to move beyond just the initial things that pop into your mind. There may be groups here that overlap, right? You may describe groups based on behavior, based on demographics, based on political affiliations, you know, whatever is relevant to your topic, and there may be people who fit in multiple groups. That's fine. But after you have those first groups jotted down, push beyond. Think more creatively and more expansively. And this is where things really get interesting, because this is where you start to identify opportunities. Those people that maybe you're not currently reaching, that maybe your coverage doesn't currently consider with the topics you're covering. How can you surface those voices in a way that informs what you're trying to do? This is also, I'm going to say it again, a process, not a product exercise. And so this map is something you can turn to over time. Maybe you identify a few initial groups that you want to reach out to. And then after you've successfully learned how you can incorporate their voices into your coverage, then you go beyond that to more groups that you put on the map. Again, bring this to your next newsroom meeting. Have everyone bring magic markers. It's going to be so much fun. See where the network maps are the same. See where they're different. Yeah. The idea of this is to understand who you want to reach, whose voices you want to surface. Linda, I'm going to give them 1 minute to keep sketching out this map.
I'm also imagining pens scribbling.
Right?
Yes.
Post-it stuck to the wall, however you want to do it. Get crafty. All right. And this again is something you can revisit. This will help inform how you reach out to people. Because let me tell you, engagement is not just about putting something on social media and then listening for the comments you get back. It's really considering what platforms you can use to reach people about the issues they care about the most. And we've seen something really interesting happen. We've seen that depending on the platform, the level of, call it buy-in, from the people, the audience members you're working with will change. The more personal the platform, for example, a newsletter opt-in or a one-on-one call with a reporter, the better quality you're going to get of questions because they're investing in a relationship with your organization. And this engagement approach allows you to deepen relationships with audience members, which is very interesting to consider when we think about converting them to sustainers, supporters, subscribers. Okay, you've got a weird looking map in your notes. Great. You've started to think about what platforms maybe you can use to reach out to people, either your existing platforms or partnerships with other places, sending out mailers, you know, depends on the topic. And again, I really welcome you to share these ideas in the chat as they're bubbling up, just for people to think about and see what other people are considering. Now you want to think about how you're going to receive your feedback, okay? crazily typing on a Google Doc. Yes, thank you. Maybe Linda, instead we should imagine mad typing happening. Again, we will provide you with the steps that we're going through in this workshop exercise so you can do it in a more expansive fashion after the conference. This is an example from Wisconsin Public Radio, which has received so many questions and produced so many wonderful stories in response to this key ask. What questions do you have about COVID-19? What questions do you have? And when you're inviting feedback, you need to be very transparent and clear about what you're going to do with that feedback. Audiences, and I don't blame them for this, might be a little skeptical about outreach efforts. If all they've ever been asked to do before is like click a button on a poll and it doesn't seem to really have any impact other than live on a box in the website, that's not really deep engagement that informs your editorial reporting. So you have to signal early and signal often that this is different, that this is listening, that this is something that is designed to help you serve them better. And we recommend that you specifically, if you can, ask people for their questions. Questions are the atomic unit of all journalism, right? If you ask someone, you know, what do you want to know about COVID-19? They might just respond, economy. Oh, that's a really big topic. If you say, what questions do you have about COVID-19? Then you get a specific actionable question that you can report out and respond to. Are you required to respond to every single question that is asked? No. This is designed to give you better insight into what your audience needs to know, and you get to choose what to pursue for your project. Be very clear about how it will be used. Be very clear in your reporting that it was audience informed. Here are some of those stories that came out of the questions that were asked. And look at how at every case they signal that the audience was a key component of reporting this out. We talk about an engagement feedback loop, okay? You invite feedback, you listen to the feedback and it informs your reporting. And then as you report it out, you invite further feedback. It is a process. It is a process that will allow you to deepen your relationship with your audience over time. Now, I've worked with every size newsroom from a one-person outfit for a local community radio in Oregon to the BBC, right? Any newsroom can do this. You can incorporate it into your workflow. And the beautiful thing about these steps and the checklist you can download at the end of our workshop today is that you can put it to work immediately. Even if you're doing one beat reporting story that you want to try this out on and learn from it and then build it out as you go. Set your goal. Think about who you're trying to reach and how you can best reach them from a learning mindset. When you ask, be really clear about what you're asking for and how it will be used, and then signal to your audience that their contributions mattered. If you've done that, then you've done audience engagement. And pause for a minute, let everyone finish typing their frantic Google Docs. And then we'll turn to how this feedback loop continues with the solutions component, whenever you're ready, Linda.
All right. I'm imagining everybody scribbling starting to slow. Okay, or typing starting to slow. So how does solutions journalism fit into this picture? Well, I'll give you a quick example. One of the ways Bridget and I have been working together, Harkin and solutions journalism been working together, is on elections coverage in the United States. Combining that engagement in solutions journalism as part of this process. We're working with a set of newsrooms who the newsrooms are asking their communities, what is the most important issue you want politicians to be talking about in competing for your vote? That's the engagement, and they're doing it in a wide variety of ways, going through that same process that Bridget just outlined. What communities do they want to reach? Some are focusing on young people. Some are focusing on different segments of their audiences, but they're all asking that question. Then what do you do with that information once you get it? Well, you know, as Bridget described, sometimes it's just questions and you want to answer, you want to spend some time answering the questions people have. But sometimes those questions are what can we do to address this issue? And that's where solutions journalism comes in. In the elections project, people are using that feedback both to publish the agenda, the citizens' agenda, it's called, of what people would like politicians, what the community would like politicians to be talking about, really putting the community more in the driver's seat when it comes to political coverage, not letting the candidates drive the agenda, but asking questions about those issues that are most important to their communities, having journalists asking those questions. So you can publish that agenda, you can ask use that information to ask politicians those questions, and you can do solutions journalism around it. Asking that question, not just you can vet the candidates' ideas for how to address those issues, and you can also bring new ideas to the table. And both of those last two methods can employ the solutions journalism approach. You can go ahead, I think, Bridget. Yeah. So you start in this part of the project to ask that question, who's doing it better? And often you're asking the question, what piece of the problem is really important to my audience? Because often you'll understand that like something big like climate change or Black infant mortality is like a huge problem that you can't address all in one story. So sometimes it's really useful to break it down and ask that question again, what piece is really important to my audience? So you've got your issue in mind. I'll give you just a few minutes to think about what piece of the problem is really important to your audience. And if you know anybody right now who's doing a better job with that, and if you don't know that yet, where you might look for that. Is it a pilot project somewhere nearby or within your community? Might you look further away? And take note of the questions on the right as well as you're typing away. When you're thinking about the piece of the problem that's really important, you can look at various ways that people might be making progress. Again, this isn't silver bullet journalism. You're not going to find the solution to a problem. We really should be called the Responses to Social Problems Network, but that doesn't sort of roll off the tongue as well as the Solutions Journalism Network. But you can look at who's making progress, who's doing progress faster, who's doing it most inexpensively. Really, a key one is where is a lot of improvement being made? It doesn't mean the problem is solved altogether, but there are efforts that are making great strides forward. Or who's having better results with various different populations. Since we can't see you, it's hard to see how fast you're typing and how much time, but I'll pause here just for a moment. All right, I'll keep going. I don't know, I can't tell how, if you're starting to slow down, but as Bridget said, we just wanna outline the steps here that you can then take back to your newsroom and flesh out even more, spend a little more time addressing these questions. So the steps in solutions journalism. So, who's doing it better? What piece of the problem is most important to your audience? And then move on to those other questions that we talked about in the KPCC example, the key one being looking for that evidence. The next question, the next step is asking, how do we know this is working? What do we know and what don't we know? which gets both at the evidence that I talked about before and also the limitations of the effort, because you need to include both in your story. The purpose of solutions journalism is to examine promising practices. And that means looking at the strengths, the weaknesses, as well as the strengths. So here's some key questions to think about. What evidence do you know that exists already? Or what might you be able to get, since evidence is key for these stories? Really, when I was doing these stories as when I was a reporter and editor at the Seattle Times in Seattle, Washington, that was really the first question we asked. If an effort didn't have evidence yet, or we couldn't get evidence around it, it didn't mean we didn't do the story, because there are other reasons to do stories, and not every story is a solution story. But without that evidence, we didn't pursue it as a solution story. Really important is looking for evidence from independent sources, right? Not just the people involved. That probably goes almost without saying to journalists in the room. Sometimes a good place to look for evidence is elsewhere, right? Asking if something is new to your community, asking that question, where did this idea come from? Because very often someone has seen it in practice or heard about it in practice somewhere else. And you can look at that effort and ask the question, well, what happened there? Did it work? Did it not work? What were the pitfalls? And you can get your evidence there. Again, you want to look at those limitations, what's working and what's not working. Look at research and consider what were the barriers of this model working in other places. And especially your community, if you're looking at it and if you're writing about a model elsewhere, that might be something that your community should consider. What are the barriers to bringing it to your community? So again, I'll pause just a second to let you type furiously. I think you can go to the next slide, Bridget, actually. Probably should have put this first, but here's a handy dandy grid that you can use to sketch out a story that, a solution story project, or just a single solution story that outlines those four elements that make up strong solutions reporting. And I've covered pretty much three of the elements on this grid. What problem are you want to address? What's the response that you want to focus on? The evidence, the limitations and the caveats. And the last box is the insights and the lessons for others. Because the purpose of these stories is to, spread good ideas, really. So, what insights and lessons does this effort have that others can learn from? Sometimes those are cautionary tales about what not to do. Sometimes they're, models of what might work elsewhere. What's working well and how? All right, I'm going to assume, just in the interest of time, again, you can take these back to your newsroom and work on this some more. But this, you know, the solutions part of this exercise also will help you deepen your relationship to your audience and serve your audience better. You know, I heard a reporter talk recently, and she said what really brought home to her the importance of solutions journalism. She had just been involved with a big investigative project about sexual assault in the agricultural industry. Essentially, it was called Rape in the Fields. And when they held focus groups with the farm workers who usually were the victims of the sexual assault, you know, those folks already knew there's a problem. You know, you have to ask yourself question, who are you writing for? They knew there was a problem. They didn't need reporting. They didn't need these stories to tell them that. What they wanted to know was how to solve it. And that's where your solutions journalism can come in and be very powerful. I've also found it can bring about the same kind of change that traditional investigative reporting has in doing solutions journalism. I've personally seen it, and we've seen it lead to change in laws, change in policies, because it takes away the excuses for not doing anything. It shows that, yes, there's something that can be done, and asks sort of that hard question, well, if this community over here is making progress, why aren't we? And again, this is also a process, not a project. Bringing a solutions lens is something you can ask on any topic, on any story, again, a project or an individual story. Is there a solutions angle here? And after you finish a story like this, either a problem story or a solution story, then you can get back into the engagement loop again as well. And part of that engagement continuum that Bridget's talking about is that you don't stop listening once the story is published. In fact, you want to listen harder. And remember that even though as a reporter, you're off and on to the next story by the time something is published, your audience is brand new to it. You want to be listening to the conversation that comes out of that to inform your future reporting, both to answer questions, to identify new angles that you might want to write about. And so the process starts again of deep listening that informs your reporting, that helps you better serve your community.
Thank you for this wonderful presentation. It was a very interactive one, amazing checklist. And my guess is that everybody is still brainstorming very heavily or scribbling away. But we do have one question received within our live chat, and it's from GS_GS. Do you have data on which platforms are working best for engaging your audience? And could you advise on simple tools for engaging people and triggering cooperation?
That's a wonderful question. And it does depend on your specific circumstances and your specific goals. But in general, we find that platforms that allow you to have regular communication with your audience, such as, for example, email, or if you are broadcasting during your broadcast segments, allow you to build that relationship and that feedback loop. Third-party platforms where you're not in control of who you're reaching, how, and when, for example, social media, we all know not our entire followings are going to see every post that we put out there, can be a good way to gather initial engagement, but you want to bring them into a more regular communication with your organization so that you can build that relationship over time. And we didn't touch on this too much today, but there is very much a business case to be made for engagement that allows you to convert people from perhaps people who read your offerings for free to paying subscribers. We've seen that these type of public powered projects do convert to subscriptions at a higher rate because you're providing a service and you're listening and you are responding to their needs and creating value that way. Yeah, please do download this checklist. It has a lot of concrete recommendations that you can just keep in mind as you pursue engagement. It's ES underscore checklist, ES for engagement solutions checklist. You can find Harkin at weareharkin.com. Again, if you want to just follow me on Twitter, I post a lot about engagement stuff. And then Linda, you want to tell people how people can connect with your organization?
Yeah, you can. We are on Twitter as well, or you can email me at linda@solutionsjournalism.org. Would love to hear if a story comes out of this presentation or some effort that you do in your newsroom. Please let us know about it. We would love to hear about it. Right, Bridget?
Absolutely. I like my sudden dramatic lighting right at the end.
Well, thank you, ladies, for sharing this link. And please share with them brainstorming insights. And yes, a quick reminder, we will be back here at 4:15.